Our message comes from Mark chapter 6, verses 7 through 12 or 13 today. That's going to be on page 996 in the Pew Bible. Mark chapter 6, 7 through 13. And he called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He charged them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not put on two tunics. And he said to them, whenever you enter a house, stay there until you depart from there. And if any place will not receive you, and they will not listen to you, when you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that people should repent. And they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and healed them. This is God's word.
Amen. Oh, it's good. Thanks, Ange, for the special music. And thank you all for coming out to worship. We have before us a text that is Mark 6, 7 through 13. A few things to say before we move into the text. We know that authority, the word authority, means a delegated right or power, delegated right or power. And this is a good way to think about that word today as we look at this passage. The terms apostle and disciple, and you've probably heard this before, you even have it in your notes. The term apostle and disciple are not synonyms. A disciple is one who learns, and an apostle is one sent out with authority from the one who commissioned him. So this is the difference. We have to understand that apostolic authority cannot be separated from Jesus. There are those today who want to do this in order to appear probably in a good light of some sort. There are no apostles today in the biblical sense. Understand that. That's very important. You have some poncing about declaring that they're apostles, but they simply are not. Not in the biblical sense. Apostolic authority, the original apostles were a particular set of men, and those days are not with us anymore. Apostolic authority is found in the Bible. It's found in the Bible, which we must adhere to. We notice today, too, that there are movements starting up where people hear from God and write down what they hear. How far away are we from developing another book of Revelation? Not far. It'd be a false book. So there are no apostles today in the biblical sense, no new revelation. The biblical criteria for apostleship include a disciple of Jesus, an eyewitness of Jesus' resurrection, and clearly and called directly by Christ. The Apostle Paul would be a bit of an exception. He was unique, but he was approved by the other apostles as an apostle. So we have to remember that. This is where we are. The Word of God is central. No one's running around writing Revelation anymore, or they ought not to be pretending to do so. So Jesus called his disciples to do a ministry very much like his own. What did he do? Proclaim, cast out, and heal. He proclaimed repentance. The kingdom is at hand, and the signs that the kingdom was breaking in were the works or miracles of casting out and healing. The passage that we're going to look at today speaks of the unique work, but it thunders a great lesson to us regarding what it means to be sent out. The people of God are not called to sit. We're called outward. We're called out there, not to sit here. We sit here in worship of God. We sit here around the glory of God. We stand here to worship Jesus, and then we go out from here to missionize the world. All of life is worship, but there is that particular moment when the body gathers to encourage one another and to go out into the world and to reach the lost. That's what this is all about. This is a fueling station where we come and encounter the living God and then go out from here. So we're going to talk about what does it mean to be sent out, and there are a few words associated with this. I want to focus on three words, all of them beginning with M, because I have a dictionary and a phone. So three M words. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you as a people sent out. We're not called to religious comfort. We're set apart and sent out. So Lord, help us to understand more of what this means and how it might apply to our hearts. Give us strength, O Lord. We need it to face the hour in which we work. We ask, Lord, that you would take that which is preached, straighten out the bent words, and nail these words into our hearts, so that we would know that we have met you today. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, we pray. I remember back at when the Second Gulf War was ramping up, I remember hearing an interview on the radio when a person associated with the National Guard stated, "I signed up for the education. I didn't sign up to fight." I thought, huh? I signed up for the education. I didn't sign up to fight. And I thought, that's strange. I mean, who goes down to the sign-up office for the military and wanders in and says, "Well, this looks like a great opportunity for me. I'll do what I can, but I don't want anything to do with fighting. I'll wear the uniform, but just keep me away from the front." Well, apparently some do. In the context of the church, when Jesus calls us out of the world, he calls us to himself. And those of you who know Jesus Christ, you know this warmth that you get. When you first come to Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, you're drawn to Jesus, you come to him, and you you delight. You begin to read the Word of God and pray, and you're with other Christians, and you attend the groups. And it's lovely. And the potlucks aren't bad. And the coffee's hot, and the rooms are warm. And in the summer, they can be cool. And so everything is fine until we realize, well, we can't just sit here. You signed on to go out, actually. You signed on to worship, to get the fuel, but then to go out into the world, wherever God calls you. And your world can be locally, or it can be in another state, or in some place around the world. Serving Jesus doesn't just mean coming together and staying there. It means going out. So today we're going to talk about what it means to be a people sent out. Three words, beginning with M. You know what it's like when you camp in the summer? One goes camping, bugs. Isn't that fun to have bugs around? And you have fires burning. Why, when it's 90 degrees? Let's get around the campfire and really roast. Well, we're going to have hot dogs. Oh, those are good for you. And marshmallows and some dubious treat of some sort. That's all fun, yeah. But the best time to camp, it seems to me, is in late September, early October, when a fire makes sense. When you're around the campfire, it's good. Crackling smell, you know, the burning of marshmallows. And you just feel warm. But then time comes to go and get bits and pieces of firewood and the brush, and so you wander away from the fire. You can still see it, and you pick up a piece here and a piece there. The conversation is, you know, it's over there somewhere. You can hear it. You can still see the fire. It's cool where you are. It's cooler. The wind blows. There are shadows. And this describes, in an illustrative way, the ministry of Christ. We're called to the warm places like this. We're called together for fellowship, but then we're sent out where it is cool and difficult and shadowy. So in our passage today, Jesus, it says in verse 7, he called the 12 and began to send them out. He called them together. Now perhaps they were back home. They were around the fires at home, enjoying the fellowship of family and friends. Maybe getting their houses in order, you know, they had to get some things together for their families. And then he called them to come back. And he didn't call them to sit around another fire and to discuss more things. You know, Jesus taught his disciples walking, standing, sitting. He taught them. And now it's time to send them out where it is cool and shadowy. And he said, he called the 12 and began to send them out. Out where? Into the world. The world where there are difficult things. A place where one will have power encounters. In Mark chapter 3, verse 15, if you'll go back there, Mark chapter 3, verse 15, the calling of the 12 apostles. I'll go back to 13 for a little context. And he went up on the mountain and called to him those whom he desired. And they came to him, and he appointed 12, whom he also named apostles, so that they might be with him and might send them out to preach. So might send them out. Now here's the time he's going to send them out. They're disciples, and he called them apostles. Why? Because they're to be taught, and then they're to go out. They're disciples and they're apostles. They go out into the world. We can learn from this as followers of Jesus. We can learn. And so we're going to learn three words that form the basis of a life sent out. A life sent out. What words must be understood in order to serve Jesus well as a people sent out? What three words, beginning with M, manner, means, and message. Manner, means, and message. What words must be understood? Understood means to take as settled. This is it. I'm taking this as a settled matter. In order to serve Jesus well as a people sent out, we are sent out. We're taught, we're fueled on Sunday as a corporate body. We come together, then you go out. And we don't sign on to sit in the Quonset hut. We sign on to serve Jesus. And it may mean out there in the immediate sense and maybe in a distant sense, or at least assisting in major ways around the world. What words must be understood? The first one is manner. Again, look at verse 7 of chapter 6 of the book of Mark. And he, Jesus, called the 12, called them together, and began to send them out two by two. The manner or the way of serving is what we're looking at here. Manner or way of serving. Note this. He called them together and sent them out two by two. Now, I think when scholars look at this, they say, okay, Deuteronomy 19:15 and Matthew 18:16 speak of witnesses. You should have at least two or three witnesses to a matter before them. And this appears to be the case here. Two people going out to verify the proclaimed message. Also, one can see here that they go out two by two to encourage each other. I don't like going out and doing individual ministry. I'd rather have someone with me following along and I joining together, being apart, praying with each other, enjoying the company and going and doing ministry to the glory of Jesus. So it was mutual involvement here. Secondly, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. Jesus gave it to them, the authority, the right to do as he had done. Those who are sent out who are those who go out under the rule of Christ. He gave them authority, so they go out under him. They're not on an equal status with Jesus. They go out under his authority, with it, under it. They go out under the rule of Christ, who is glorious. So the manner of serving, the manner in which we go out is we go out in a mutual sense, we go together to encourage each other. But above this, we go out under authority, the rule of Christ. Mark chapter 1, verse 11. I'm going to read just a couple of passages. I want to make this clear to people like me. I need to hear this. Mark 1 and verse, look at 9 through 11. This is the baptism of Jesus. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens opening and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven. You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased. This is the glory of Christ. He is the glorious Son of God. So we're sent out under the authority of the glorious Son of God. Now listen to this. In Colossians chapter 1. Paul, under the power of the Holy Spirit, says this about Jesus. This is the one under whom we go. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, meaning he's preeminent. For by him all things were created. Verse 15 of Colossians 1, note. In heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. That's the one who sent the apostles out. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. We'll just stop there. Much, much more to be said. What does this say? Christ is the supreme ruler. He's the agent of creation of the Father, the firstborn of all creation. He's supreme. He is the very Son of God, glorious. This is the one under whom we go. We do not go under denominations primarily. We go under the authority of Jesus. Here's the question for my soul. When I see myself in a sent out role, under whose authority do I go? A Jesus of my own creation? Or merely on my own? If we go under the authority of Jesus, we go, in a good sense, shaking, because he has sent us. We're sent out And we go submitting to him, recognizing that this work is delightful and necessary, and there isn't any other like it. We go out under Christ. That is the manner. In a moment, we will apply. Right now, take in and heed the questions to our souls. Secondly, this is manner. That's verse 7. We turn to verses 8 through 10 and discuss means. That is available resources. Means. At this time, Jesus, he charged them to take nothing for their journey except a staff. Parallel accounts talk about leaving the rod behind, the discipline rod, and taking the staff, the walking stick. All they were to take was a walking stick. No bread, no bag, no money in their belts. But to wear sandals and not put on two tunics. And he said to them, wherever you enter, whenever you enter a house, stay there until you depart from there. Okay, here is the deal. Jesus said, you're to go out. You are to go out with no money. Let's look at it. All right, just to take your walking stick. No food, no bag. Don't take any extra provisions but that which is on your back. No money, no money. You're only to wear one tunic. In other words, in the ancient days, when you traveled, you had two tunics. You know, if there was no Super 8 around, you would have to put your second tunic on and wrap up and in some area of the wilderness. Mm-mm. Not here. They are to go and to be indoors. They are to find a place to rest indoors. They are to rely on people. And he said to them, whenever you enter a house, stay there until you depart from there. In other words, you're not going to look for a better offer. So you're going into this house. So what that you get beans three times a day? If somebody down the road says, I have bacon, you stay put. It's not about privilege. It's not about comfort. It's about service. So all of this is geared toward, this is an issue of means. We're not to trust in our own resources, but in the resources of God. Now, in this particular case, he emphasizes this. Trust God for food and money and housing and warmth. So this is the means or the available resource. That's what they were to do. Trust in God. Trust him. No one else. Here's the question for my soul. Do we minister out of our personal trust and available resources or through the power of God? Do we minister out of personal trust and available resources or through the power of God? Imagine what would happen. Think about this. If we were able to pack out by the grace of God Wednesday night and begin to pray, as we have prayed and continue to pray, we have a good group, good time, but man, oh man, you know what is most exciting is in the small rural church is to see God move with power, to see God fund Reverend Outa. That's amazing to me, and I just praise God. You know, it's just so incredible. And we say, well, this year is done, and my goodness, we have a few bucks in the account. How could we even look to the next semester? Well, he provided for the first. So we get together and we pray, God, help us. We pray for the other things. We have two students going to Summit, and these are leaders. These are young people with leader all over them. You know, just gobs of leadership potential. And I'm thinking, what an investment. And isn't God good to provide open doors like this? Think of the power unleashed if we would just, I would just trust him. I love to rely on my own resources. How about you? God, you're so good. I was called to give and I gave exactly what I had here that is in my pocket and you just provided it. Oh, wait a minute. Doesn't God call people like me to be sacrificial and to trust in him instead of what I have already? It's all right. It's good to have that. But wait a minute. What about this trust? Relying on him and him alone to the glory of his name. What a privilege. Maybe that's what God is doing in the West, is taking away our financial means and all the stuff and giving us only him. Wouldn't that be amazing? Oh God, available resources and means, they're to depend on him. What a lesson. What words must be understood or taken as settled in order to serve Jesus well as a people sent out? Well, if I'm sent out, which I am, I didn't sign on to sit. I signed on to be sent out somehow, some way. So there's a manner of going out, a way of serving, and that's under the rulership of Christ. Mutual encouragement, yeah, but under the rulership and the authority of Christ, we go out in his name. Imagine going door to door and saying, and I think I'll do this from now on. Hi, I'm so-and-so. I'm from that church. I'm here under the authority of Jesus Christ. What kind of a stare are you going to get from that? Maybe a good one. Maybe a good one, because that's true. If I'm not here under his authority, what am I doing out there? I'm here under the authority of Jesus Christ. What right do you have to tell me that I need to be converted? I come under the authority of Jesus Christ. I'm an ambassador. I'm an ambassador from a distant land. It's called the kingdom of God. And I'm here to tell you about Jesus. Maybe so. And then, of course, we have means, trusting in God alone. Trusting in God. Oh, he gives us resources and we use them and we thank God for that. But what if we gathered for prayer? Wouldn't it be great if we had more people on Wednesday night than on Sunday morning? Won't be hard. If we did that, can you imagine God bringing more people on Wednesday night to pray than on Sunday morning? Imagine the power unleashed. Then there's message, that which is proclaimed. Look at verses 11 through 13. And if any place will not receive you, in other words, they're indifferent to Jesus, and they will not listen to you. Emphatic, symphatic language. They will not receive you, they will not listen to you. This is psalmic as well. In the Psalms you see repetition, emphasizing they won't receive you, they won't listen to you. They're saying to Jesus, they're stiff-arming him. I don't want that. Shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. Historically, we know this, that people who were out, Jews who were out in Gentile territories, when they returned, it was their habit to shake the dust off their feet when they reached the boundary of Israel, because they didn't want to defile the land. So, Jesus is using this picture, though, this way. If you come and someone rejects me, rejects the message, shake the dust off their feet, because they are unclean. They are in danger of judgment. Shake the dust off that is on your feet as a testimony against them. Judgment. This is part of the message, is judgment. And then, verse 12. So they went out and proclaimed that people should repent. What does repentance mean? It means a deep sorrow over sin. We've said it before, we'll say it again. It's not this, sorry, 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 God. It's a deep sorrow over sin. So you have judgment. And you have a call to repentance. Repentance is crucial because it reminds us that we serve a God who is deeply offended by our sin and by all sin. Deeply offended. One of my favorite writers, Thomas Watson from the 1600s, wrote this: "He who hides one rebel in his house is a traitor to the crown. The person who indulges one sin is a traitorous hypocrite. So, I'm a traitorous hypocrite who needs Jesus every day. Help me. I can't do the law on my own, in my own strength. I have to rely on Jesus, who can do the law. Jesus does the law. I don't. On my own. He does it, and I trust him." Repentance reminds us that God is deeply offended by our sin. And those who resist Christ, who reject Christ, are subject to judgment. Oh, man. They're subject to the fires of hell. And we have minimized the horror of sin and the judgment of hell in the West. But this is part of the message, that people should repent. It has been said by those, by certain scholars, that if you were to take one of these unrepentant people, this shows how deep human nature is opposed to God. Unsupported by the power of the Holy Spirit, human nature opposes God. If you were to take one of those people, unrepentant people, take them, if it was possible, to take them to heaven and put them at the banquet table of heaven, they would look around and hate every morsel on that table and delight in the sinful food. Human nature just does not want God, unaided by God. It doesn't want it. And such living is a horror to God. So the message is the call to repent, to turn away from sin and delight in the things of heaven. Judgment. In Acts chapter 13, verse 51, we see that the apostles dusted their feet off as a statement of judgment. Repentance. Vital. Now verse 13. "And they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and healed them." Signs of the new covenant. Signs of the kingdom. Here they are, the apostles, signs of the kingdom. Does the church engage in the laying on of hands and the anointing of oil? Yep, James 5, sure. Do we encounter evil? Oh yes, world, flesh, and devil every day. We encounter that in word and prayer. But we're not apostles in this sense. But we learn from this. We go out under the authority of Jesus. These people imitated his ministry by the power of the Holy Spirit. And we go out in this power too. Message, that which is proclaimed. A message of judgment. A message of a call to repentance and of grace. Notice, people set free from the power of the devil. That's what we see. That's the message. Here are some questions. How urgent is our ministry? How urgent is this? There are many who live nearby us who are bound for hell by all appearances. These are the people who do not delight in the Word of God. You can show them the Word and they will say to you, I want nothing to do with it. I'll live only this far, but no more. They must needs have Jesus. How urgent is our ministry? What do we say to them? Do we show them Jesus and call for trust in him? You must trust in him. You must. So there is the message. How urgent is our ministry? We are sent out. Oh God, Send us to the people. Let us bring the message. So what words must be understood in order to serve Jesus well as a people sent out? Manner, means, and message. We are sent out. A few applications and then we'll close. One, be encouraged that we gather here around the fire of Christ, and from here we go out to serve in a cool and a dark world, in a difficult world. We go out. We're sent out. We're people sent out. That's what we're about. So God, give us a heart for simple and passionate worship. Simple and passionate. Centered around word and prayer. Centered around the simple things. I don't want a show. I want that. We want to encounter the living God through word and prayer. And again, come and pray, if you can, on Wednesday evenings, 6:30 till 8. And watch God build his kingdom. Come and pray. Seek his face. And watch what happens. Thirdly, study the good doctrines of the faith. Study the good doctrines of the faith. The doctrine of the provision of God for his people. Has there ever been a moment in your life as a believer where you've had to sit down and say, I am totally undone. God has utterly and absolutely deserted me. I cannot say that. I cannot, because he has been there and will continue to be there even to the end of the age. He has promised so. Of what should we worry? Study the doctrine of provision. Study the doctrine of hell. Our lost neighbors and friends are under the sword of justice and over the fires of hell. Let that give us urgency, as the disciples had. And lastly, where do we stand? Do we stand under judgment, or do we stand under grace? If we are under grace, thank God, because somebody, somehow, some way, brought the message to you and to me. And at that point, we listen. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, we proclaim from our soul on out, yes, I need Jesus in order to forgive me of my sins and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness and to give me a new life, a life that is dependent on him. I need Jesus. If we're standing under grace, celebrate it. But if we're standing under judgment right now, the Holy Spirit is saying, you are hanging by a thread over the fires of hell. You must repent. Then the challenge upon your soul now, if the Holy Spirit is at work, to repent, to turn away from sin and trust in Jesus Christ. Jesus who died, rose, ascended, and is coming again. He paid the penalty for sinners like me on the cross. I need him. I need the forgiveness that comes only from Jesus. Do not spurn that today. Do not. Perhaps this is the day when the dust will be shaken off. Do not flee from this message. Flee to Christ. Receive him and begin a new life. A life that is warm and joyous. And a life that is a life sent out to reach others with the glorious gospel proclaimed. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you and we thank you for the privilege that we have to look into the Word of God. We see herein today, although we see unique apostles, we see examples of service, we see examples of those who are sent out. And so are we sent out by the Great Commission. Go ye therefore into all the world. And our world can be smaller than others. Our world can be more local. We can have influence abroad. But yet, Lord, we are a people sent out. So let us not be content. Let us not be content with just ever sitting and taking in, but with going out and serving you somehow, some way, to your honor and glory. Lord, teach us, encourage us in the manner and the means and the message of those who were sent out. We ask all of this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We thank you.